This is paper one. I'll be doing this analysis in two parts. This is part one, and part two will be also done by me, but in the later parts. Hello everyone. Today I'll be doing a UPSC psychology optional paper analysis. This is paper one. I'll be doing this analysis in two parts. This is part one, and part two will be also done by me, but in the later parts. So let's start with analysis. Now, the first question that came was that how is descriptive type research different from your diagnostic research? And they are asking you that you have to answer this question giving suitable example. Now, what is descriptive type research and what is diagnostic type research? Now, what is descriptive? Now, they're saying that here you have to give a complete description and this complete description should be done without any manipulation of the variable. Now, if you are doing any kind of descriptive research, what is going to happen is that you are going to take various kind of activities into reference. And what are those? For example, you are going to look towards the observations. You are going to test various experiments. You are even going to do what? Detailed analysis. So what you need to do is that you need to explain what descriptive type research is, and then you have to talk about the psychologists who are favoring this type of research. For example, had I been there, I would have gone for Jean Piaget. Now, Jean Piaget is one such psychologist who have talked about that whether you are doing any kind of descriptive type research, what you need to do is you need to favor the experimenting methods. Fine. So this is about Jean Piaget. Now the next, you can also talk about the another sociologist, that is again B.F. Skinner. Now B.F. Skinner was of the opinion that in order to analyze the behavior of animals, or for that matter humans, what you need to do is you need to experiment on the conditioning of those. So what you need to do here is analyze the conditioning. Okay, so you can do more of this descriptive, you can write many things about descriptive type research, but since the question is carrying 10 marks and you have to also write about the diagnostic research, I would prefer this much. But if you want to add on, you can definitely add on, right? Now let's move on to the another part of the question, which says diagnostic research. Now, what is diagnostic research? Now, if you go with the dictionary meaning also that talks about diagnostic. So, diagnosis is that you are going to talk about what? Interrelation. And this interrelation is between what? For example, you are going to talk about what event is going to cause what kind of effect. For example, if a person is having stress, or if a student is facing stress, then it might be because of the academic performance of the student. So what you can do here is you can also give an example of stress level based on academic performance. So you can very well explain this through example, that how stress level is based on the academic performance of the student. Now here what you can do is that you can give the analysis of Sigmund Freud and what Sigmund Freud has talked about. So Sigmund Freud have also talked about what you should actually understand the difference, or you should also analyze the underlying cause. And this underlying cause is, for example, if any kind of activity or any kind of event that has occurred in a person's life. So Sigmund Freud has given the emphasis on diagnosing that event and the underlying cause, that why that event occurred. So Sigmund Freud is actually talking about underlying causes for any kind of for any kind of the activity that occurred. Fine. So this was about Sigmund Freud. You can also talk about Stanley Milgram. Now, Stanley Milgram has talked about what? Stanley Milgram has talked about the influence on anybody based on the behavior. So if a person is influenced, or any kind of this activity has happened, that means the influence is caused because of some kind of behavior. So all in all, we have talked about four psychologists. One was Jean Piaget, B.F. Skinner, then we talked about Sigmund Freud, and then we went with Stanley Milgram. Okay, so this is how I will attempt the first part of the first question, and since it was 10 marker question, so I think this would be enough, but you can add on based on your requirements. Let's move on to the second one. And the second question says that mental health study is the major trend in psychological studies in the 21st century. That means mental health study is the major trend in psychological studies in 21st century. So if you are reading the newspaper, I guess today only I have done the analysis also, and that talked about how mental health is becoming a severe issue among the elderly. So that was focused on one vulnerable group, but since the question is here about the mental health study in the 21st century, so definitely that could act as a very important relevant fact for this question. But let's first do what mental health study is. So mental health study, now they are talking about the various psychological studies. So what you need to do is that you need to talk about the various psychologists who have talked about mental health. So I would rather go with Martin Seligman, now Martin Seligman has talked about what? Now, Martin Seligman has said that mental health plays a very big role. And big role in what? In a person's behavior and attitude. And if I talk about attitude, what could be this? For example, if a person is optimistic, whether the person is looking towards a thing in a negative aspect or pessimist attitude, anything. What I mean to say is that Martin Seligman has said that it is because of the mental health that the person's behavior towards the society or towards themselves is because of these reasons. That means the kind of mental health the person possesses. Fine, so this was about Martin Seligman. Now here you can also quote about Aaron. And Aaron Beck has talked about cognitive behavioral therapy. Now in this cognitive behavioral therapy, any of the serious students know that Beck is talking about CBT. And what is CBT? That means you need to analyze the mental health of a person based on evidences. So that means the person, the psychologist, that is Beck, is talking about this therapy. So it is, you can cure the person based on evidence. So that means evidence-based therapy, basically. So you can describe this evidence-based therapy. That means you can also talk about what? You can talk about the cause of depression. The cause of anxiety, etc. So anxiety, depression, etc. And this could be cured through evidence-based therapy, etc. Now, these are two psychologists. Since the question is 10 markers, so we can write about three more psychologists. So after these two, I would prefer the next psychologist. And the next psychologist, I would rather go for Elaine Aron. Now, what has Elaine Aron talked about? Now, Elaine Aron has also given the significance of importance of mental health. And how has Aron talked about this? Now, Aron has said that if a person is experiencing hypersensitivity, so a person experiencing heightened sensitivity should also go for what? They should also, they are also prone to these mental health issues. So he has also talked about what? They have also talked about that analyzing mental health in 21st century is very important because that is going to affect the nature and the behavior of the person in the society. Behavior and nature of person, in the society. Okay, so I talked about Aaron Beck. I talked about Ilan Aaron. I have talked about Martin Selingham. Now I'm going to talk about what? Halpern. That means Dina Halpern. So the next one is Dina Halpern. Now, Dina has talked about what? Dina has emphasized on critical thinking. So if a person is going through any mental health issues, so what they need to do is that they need to critically analyze the situation. So once they're critically analyzing the situation, what is going to happen? They can, you know, to some extent, they can check over the mental health. So Dina Halpern has talked about what? Critical analyzation. Other than that, like all of this, you can also talk about Daphne Lemish, and Daphne Lemish has actually given the emphasis of digital media. So you can talk about Daphne Lemish and emphasize the role of digital media, role of digital media over mental health. Like what kind of effect these digital media is going to create over the mental health of the person. So the person has talked very strictly over the influence of digital media on mental health. This was how I was. I think I would have attempted this 1B. Now let's move on to the next question. The next question says that what do you mean by subliminal perception? Discuss its role in advertising with the help of suitable examples. So if you you know, just focus on each and every question, what they are saying is that you need to know what you just it's not about theoretical aspect. You should know how practically the situations are related. So they are asking you the root cause also, and then also asking you whether you are able to connect it or not, because if you're not able to connect it, it's very difficult to attempt the question. And since it's paper one, so if you see, there's a lot of dynamic aspect that is also coming. That means they're asking you examples. So they're asking you how you could relate it from a day-to-day event. Okay. So what do you mean by subliminal perception? What do you understand by this? That is how this subliminal perception is playing a big role in advertising with the advertising field. So what you need to do is you need to explain it, subliminal perception. So what is subliminal perception? Subliminal perception is that you or the person, without any kind of conscious awareness, for example, I'm not aware of a certain thing, but yet my mind is very sharp to perceive it. So you are perceiving it without any awareness. So perceiving without any That means the mind is perceiving without any conscious awareness. That means your mind is perceiving the things that you are not consciously aware of. For example, most of the time, if you see, whenever you're watching any cricket match, etc., so you have these advertisements of Coca-Colas and popcorns and etc. So what is happening is that even though you just don't sit back and realize this, that whether you want it or not, but subconsciously what happens is that you just go over there, you purchase it, and then you have it. So this is what subliminal perception is. Now here what you can do is that you can talk about the various messages, and you can talk about the messages that I told is coming from the advertisement. So advertisement messages, it could be anything. Like I just gave you an example of a cricket match. You can go for anything. It could be movies and anything. So advertisement. So advertisements that are giving certain messages. So you can quote any of them. Now what you need to do is, since the paper is of psychology, so you have to relate it with psychologists. So here you can talk about James Vickrey. So you can define the whole concept from from the perspective of James Vickrey, and the person has talked about subliminal perception in this context only. So you can talk about anything with respect to, for example, the stimulus the brain is gaining out of what? Out of these perceptions. And what is happening is that we are reacting towards it subconsciously. Okay, so this is how you have to attempt this question. Now let's move on to the next one. The next question says that your relative is going through chemotherapy. So they have given you a situation-based question. Now this is a situation-based question. This situation-based question is regarding what? Your relative is going through chemotherapy. How your knowledge about learning theories will be helpful? That means you have to talk about the learning theories. Then you have to solve this case. And what is that? How your theories are going to be helpful for this relative. So this is what the question is asking you. So what you can talk about is that you can give the concepts of various learning theories. For example, okay, so the first question that is coming from the first and learning theory that you can talk about is social learning theory. And this social learning theory is given by Albert Bandura. So what you can do is you can explain this social learning theory, that means the importance of self-efficacy in order for stress management. So Albert Bandura's theory of self-efficacy. Fine. Other than that, what you can talk about is you can talk about observational learning. So observational learning is coming from where? So observational learning theory. This observational learning theory is again one of the concepts that was given by Albert Bandura only. And the person has emphasized on what? That you need to observe others. That means by observing others, what you can do is that you will kind of would like to imitate them, would kind of perceive them, how they are dealing with the situation. So here observational learning theory is talking about observing others. And observing others, and in the meantime, trying to imitate them as well. Fine. This was the second one, that means the observational learning theory. First I talked about was social learning theory. Now you can talk about communication skills also, because that also act as a very important part, because the way you communicate could actually boost the confidence of the person. So communication skills. And this skill has been talked about or talked by Carl Rogers. So you can talk about Carl Rogers' theory. That means how important it is to communicate well, because if you lack the skill of communication, the things become very redundant. So if you are communicating well with the person, according to Carl Rogers, it says that it is going to act as a very effective learning. So Carl Rogers' perspective. So communication skills by Carl Rogers. Now various psychologists have also talked about stress management theory. So you can talk about the stress management theory as well. So the next focus should be on stress management theory. Now, what is stress management theory talking about? Now, stress management theory is that if a person is going through a lot of stress or pressure, so what they need to do is that, they need to focus on the positive aspects of the situation, or you can say the positive aspect of the life. So what happens is that meanwhile in the process, they could manage the stress. Okay, fine. What is the next question demanding? The next question talks about, discuss the factors facilitating in problem solving. So the factors facilitating problem solving. So first, you need to define what a problem is, and then they are asking you the factors. So what you can do is that, see, first you need to analyze the problem. So analysis of the problem is important. Then what you need to do is that you need to facilitate what you can go with creative thinking aspect. So when you are doing creative thinking, what you are doing is you are looking at a different or from different perspectives towards a single problem. So creative thinking, analyzing the problem, then what you can do is that you should know that the problem is related to which domain. So domain specific problem. That means once you know which domain the problem is, you can actually find the most appropriate and the most accurate solution to it. So analyzing the problems, creative thinking, then domain specific solution for the problem. Other than that, what else could be done is you can read upon the theories and the hypothesis. Related to problem. Fine, so these are the factors that would help in facilitating the problem solving. This is how you can go with it. If you want, you can talk about emotional intelligence also. Emotional intelligence, why? Because in paper one you have talked about Daniel Goleman. So what you can do is emotional intelligence. And the importance of emotional intelligence by Daniel Goleman. Fine, so Daniel Goleman talked about it that if the person is emotionally intelligent, what is happening is that the person will not get emotionally drawn towards any problem. So would rather think more accurately on how to, you know, solve that problem. So yeah, this was about problem solving. Yeah, let's move on to the next question. The next question says that explain in detail the use of computer technology in psychological studies. So explain in detail the use of computer technology in psychological studies. Give your answer citing appropriate recent work in the field. Okay, so we need to rely on the emphasis of computer technology, how computer technology is relevant with respect to psychological studies. Fine, so how is this going to happen? Now what you need to do is here you can talk about, first you can give a brief introduction about computer technology. With respect to the psychologist, you can talk about Alan Neville. Then you can also give the importance of the study of Sorry, you can also talk about the use of computer technology for psychological studies through Simon. Fine, so Alan Neville, Simon, etc. And what they have said is that in order to have a very, a thinking where you are going to do the analysis for having what or for making an appropriate decision. So you need to do a better analysis for having a better decision. For that you require computer technology. Why? Because computers are algorithm based. Or you can say they are more of machine learned devices. Fine. So you can talk about Alan Neville. You can talk about Simon. Then you can also talk about. Again, Stalin Milgram. Stanley Milgram. Now, why Stanley Milgram? Because Stanley Milgram emphasized on the fact that the thinking aspect becomes one of the bases of thinking aspects becomes one of the bases of psychological study, and this could be done, or this could be or this could begin from computer technology. Fine. Other than that, you can also talk about Bookhammer. Stanley Milgram, and then you can talk about Bookhammer also. And Bookhammer with respect to what? That Bookhammer has actually talked about the fact that these technologies are very helpful in dealing what they actually bring in autism. So what is autism doing? Now autism will help in diagnosing any kind of issue that is there with respect to the psychology of the person. So autism is actually talking about diagnosing of the issues. Fine. This is about Stanley Milgram, Bookhammer. Fine. Other than that, you can also talk about virtual reality. You can also give the example of Elizabeth Loftus. So virtual reality, yes, because since robotics and artificial intelligence are there, so virtual reality again plays a very important role, because if you're going to create that virtual reality, the person will be able to analyze the situation in one go. So it will be helpful in psychologically treating the person well. So virtual reality, yes. And you can also talk about Elizabeth Loftus. So this was for computer technology. Next is describe multiple intelligence theory and its measurement. Now, first you need to do what? You need to understand what is multiple intelligence theory, what they are talking about, and how you are going to measure with respect, like you are going to measure your intelligence with respect to this theory. So what you need to do is first explain what is multiple intelligence theory, then how you are going to measure your intelligence based on this theory. Fine. So first we need to understand what is multiple intelligence theory. What is multiple intelligence theory? So what you can do is you can you should in fact talk about Howard Gardner. Howard Gardner. And what are you going to talk about him? Now you are going to talk about his theory of multiple intelligence. And now what is multiple intelligence? For example, intelligence are of many forms. For example, you have spatial intelligence. What is this spatial intelligence? Now, spatial intelligence is the person is intelligent enough to read the maps, read the geographical context through visual aspects. So, what you can talk about is spatial intelligence. Reading the maps, it could be your geographical maps, it could be your Google Maps, so one form of intelligence is this. Now other form of intelligence, for example, linguistic intelligence. Some people are very sharp and are very intelligent, intelligent enough to be, you know, they are able to assess different languages. So that is one form of intelligence, that is linguistic intelligence. That they are able to perceive different languages. Fine. Apart from that, there is musical intelligence also. Yeah, spatial intelligence, linguistic intelligence, musical intelligence. Why musical intelligence? See, for people like us, for layman's like us, what happens is that we are not able to understand the notes of a music. For example, it is written in a very different form. So musical notes, musical intelligence, yes. And why musical intelligence? Because they can read the notes. Of the music. And for we couldn't even understand like what are these notes, high pitch, low pitch, etc. So the notes of the music. So one is your musical intelligence, linguistic intelligence, yes. Now, the next thing, what else? Now, they have talked about bodily kinesthetic intelligence also. So, bodily kinesthetic intelligence. One second. Yeah, bodily. Kinesthetic intelligence. What is this kind of intelligence? Certain people are very sharp enough to read the actions of the person. So, bodily kinesthetic intelligence, you can talk about this intelligence also. Fine. Now, yes, linguistic intelligence, spatial intelligence, musical intelligence, bodily kinesthetic intelligence. You can talk about naturalistic intelligence. Naturalistic intelligence, yes. Now, naturalistic intelligence, what is happening is that you can perceive the nature. That means you have this ability to read the nature. And how are you going to read the nature? For example, you are recognizing or you are understanding the patterns of the nature. So if a person is able to understand patterns of the nature. Fine, so this is naturalistic intelligence. So these are your multiple intelligence, and this is what multiple intelligence theory is about. You have to write about Gardner's viewpoint. Now, let's move on to the next one. Why is research method considered to be the backbone of any research? So, why is research method considered to be the backbone of any research? Discuss various steps undertaken in psychological research for sound and reliable results. Now, first, what you need to do is that you need to explain why is research method considered to be the backbone of any research. So we can start here with talking about the reliability. The research is carrying with it, and the rigorous work that goes behind in any research. Fine. So what you need to do is that you need to first make it very clear that why research methods are considered to be the backbone of any research, because there's a lot of rigorous work that has gone behind, and the reliability of the research work is extremely crucial. for that matter. Okay, so based on this, now how or what are the various steps to be undertaken in psychological research for sound and reliable results? Okay, so now you have to talk about the various steps. So let's start with various steps. So what you could talk about is, you can talk about the relevance of relevance of hypothesis you can talk about how the data collection is happening. So for that matter, you should know about data analysis. So data analysis, since they're talking about the steps, so just write about the steps, that is data analysis, the hypothesis that is going behind. Then you can talk about sampling, data collection, etc. When you are collecting data relevant to the field of your research, then also you are doing enormous amount of hard work. So for that matter, data collection becomes an important part. So data collection, sampling, hypothesis, data analysis, they all become what steps for psychological research. Then you can also talk about the literature review. That means you are going to review the back analysis of why a particular kind of data is being taken or being extracted. So back analysis of So back analysis of data. Now you can talk about if you want that this is relevant for you. I mean, that depends upon person to person. If you feel that ethical consideration is important for you, then go ahead with ethical consideration as well. That means what is the percentage or what is the proximity or probability of the data being true. So yeah, ethical consideration. Then you can talk about various psychologists over here, but this is how first you need to frame out the question, and once you have framed out the answer to it, then you can definitely use the psychological perspectives with respect to this. Fine. Okay, the next question says that describe the factors influencing perceptual organization. Describe the factors influencing perceptual organization with reference to past experiences and perceptual readiness. Here what you need to do is you need to one second, perceptual organizations. Okay, yes, so perceptual organization with reference to past experiences and perceptual readiness. Okay, so what is perceptual organization? Now, if you even don't know about the question, or if you don't know about the terms, for example, perceptual organization, what does that mean? So perceptual organization, see, whatever you have perceived, based upon your past experiences, based upon your day-to-day experiences, etc. So whenever you are going to analyze a situation, what is going to happen is that you are going to do it based upon your perceptions, and these perceptions are coming not from just one day scenario. It is happening from a lot of time, or you can say from your past experiences, etc. So it is basically a perception of or perceptions that your brain analyzes. And analyzes based on what? Based upon your past experiences. Based upon whatever you are experiencing from your day-to-day life, etc. So this is a perceptual organization. That means all your experiences, events, etc. You are going to analyze anything based upon your, or based on taking the references from past experiences, and then you are ready for any situation, or for that matter, if any situation calls out for a quick response. So what is going to happen is that you are going to perceive, and this perceptual organization is based on what? The factors that happened in your past scenarios or the experiences that you get. So this is what perceptual organization is. Now here you can talk about Bruner, because they are the one, or these are the psychologists who have actually talked about perceptual organization. So one is your Bruner, because they have given, or they have talked about the perceptual readiness. And what is perceptual readiness? That means how after perceiving anything, you are going to organize those events. So once you organize those events very well in your mind, so based on that you are going to answer, or you are going to tackle a situation. So that is, what you are going to do is you are going to organize. The experiences, the events, and for that reason, that means once you are able to organize the experiences or events, and then you are going to perceive it and then analyze it. Analyze, for that matter, anything. Okay, so you are going to talk about Bruner. You can also talk about Gestalt psychology. Okay, just wait. Write about the Bruner, and you can also talk about Gestalt psychology. Now what is Gestalt psychology? Gestalt psychology is talking about what? How your sensory inputs are analyzing, or sensory inputs are putting the patterns and experiences . So how your sensory inputs, that means again, this is what exactly they meant, that you are perceiving something from your past experiences, and how your sensory inputs are going to read those patterns and those experiences, and how they are going to organize it. And based on that organization, again, you are going to, make decisions. So, analyzing the patterns, experiences, then organizing them. And then making decisions. Fine. Now, this was about your perceptual organization. Yes. You perceive things based on your experiences. And after that, what you do is that you organize them well in your brains, and then what you do is you make decisions based on those experiences. Okay, fine, let's move on to the next question. What do you understand by psychological and physiological basis of motivation? Again, the question says that what is the difference, or how will you comprehend what the psychological means, like psychologically you are motivated, and physiologically motivation is happening. Fine. So based on this, you have to answer the question, that is psychological and physiological basis of motivation. Discuss, then giving suitable examples. Fine. So what is psychological basis of motivation? Now again, psychological is something that is through your psychic that is happening. Now, psychic is what? It could be anything. For example, if here you are going to write about the theory of Clark Hull. Now, this is for your psychological basis of motivation. So, what has Clark Hull talked about? So, the psychologist has talked about drive reduction theory. So once you are explaining about Clark Hull, so what you can do is you can write about this theory, drive reduction theory. If I go with drive reduction theory, what is happening is that drive reduction theory says that this happens, or this kind of psychological motivation happens through physiological imbalance. What is that? For example, the person is very hungry. So based on that hunger, the person is going to work. So for him, the motivation of work is this hunger. Physiological hunger. So this kind of impacts the psychic of the person, and when this hunger impacts the psychic of the person, then the person works. So one motivation is your drive reduction theory. Then is your incentive theory. You can give the example of B.F. Skinner. B.F. Skinner has talked about what? B.F. Skinner has talked about incentive theory. Now, what is incentive theory about B.F. Skinner? Now, B.F. Skinner is saying that when a person gets incentive, so what happens is the motivation occurs. So that helps the psyche of the person to work. So motivation is coming from incentives. Then you can talk about self-determination theory. Now, this self-determination theory is what? Now, based on this self-determination theory, the person is doing all this kind of work, like that is driven by internal factors. For example, it could be external pressure, it could be internal pressure, anything. So, if external pressure is there, external pressure is there, that is extrinsic, and intrinsic may when there is internal motivation. Okay, so this was about your psychological basis of motivation. Now, you can talk about physiological basis. Now, what are physiological basis? Now, see, if you analyze what is happening is that there is a very fine line that creates a difference between a psychological and physiological basis of motivation. And how is this happening? See, psychological and physiological basis of motivation, the difference is that all these factors were creating an impact on the psyche of the person, but the factors were very external. So the factors were external, but it was creating impact on the psyche of the person. So I have put this theory on psychological basis. When you are studying the physiological basis, what is happening is, under physiological basis, for example, if you know, if the person is rewarded, now this reward is external. So based on this reward, there is what, you know, the person will get motivated to work for. So why? Because there is a certain kind of chemical that is released, that is your dopamines. So what is happening is that this dopamine helps in what? Motivating the person. Fine. So the dopamines are there. Then you can talk about this theory. And who has given this theory? This theory is being given by Kent Berridge. Other than that, you can talk about Cannon's theory. That is, again, the Cannon's theory is based or the person or the psychologist canon is what they're talking about or what opinion they are carrying is that there should be a hunger to achieve something. Now, this achieving something is related to what? This is leading to, if a person is hungry, if the person is not able, is not a satiate, I would say, the satiation process is not there. So what is happening is that this will be a constant source of motivation for that person. So Canon has talked about the hunger and lack of satiation. That means that would act as what? Physiological basis of motivation. Physiological basis of motivation, yes. Fine. Then what you can talk about here is fight and flight response. Again, what is flight and fight or flight response? So this theory was again given by Canon only. Fight or flight response. Now, what is your fight and flight response? Now, this flight and fight response is that there is a motivation under the person what to or the potential under the person to quickly respond to the situation. So quick response either you fight back or you run away. So this response is either you have to face the situation. If the bear is coming in front of you, what are you going to do? Either you have to run away or you have to fight back. So quick response is one of the bases of motivation. Fine. This is about psychological and physiological basis of motivation. So these are the respective theories. You can write all of them depending upon what is your or how you are placing it on the paper. Now the next question is discuss some key ideas from psycho-cybernetics. Some key ideas from psycho-cybernetics. Fine. So what you need to do here is that you need to talk about psycho-cybernetics. What is psycho-cybernetics? What you can do here is you can talk about Maxwell Maltz. Now Maxwell Maltz has talked about what? Now he's the one who has given what? A self-help book. Now this self-help book is talking about your psycho-cybernetics. So what is this self-help book about? So what you can write about here is that how the various self-improvement strategies are going to affect your psyche. So self-improvement strategies self-help is going to improve your psychology. Fine. So how, and now the question is asking you about some key ideas. So what are those ideas, or how your psychology is going to improve, or so that key ideas you have to write about in this question. So what are those key ideas? So you can talk about self-image. You can also talk about self-fulfilling prophecies. Yeah. Self-fulfilling prophecies. That means, whatever steps you are taking, those key ideas, that means your self-help techniques, your self-fulfilling prophecies. Now, this was also given by Marx, Maxwell Marx. So, self-fulfilling prophecies. Now, goal setting is one more step towards it. So if you have set a goal, what is going to happen is that psychologically you are constantly thinking about that goal achievement. So your goal setting acts as important part over there. Then is your there's one more thing that you can talk about is that one more thing is plastic surgery of mind. Plastic surgery of mind. Now, what is this? Now, this plastic surgery of mind is that you are emphasizing a lot in changing your own self-image. Fine. So, based on this, you can write about many other key ideas also. Right? Let's move on to the next one. The next question says that you compare and contrast between programmed and probability learning, also highlight advantages and disadvantages. Now, programmed one is again very algorithm based. Probability is something you are working upon. What should I say? It is based on more of percentage probability. That means, what amount of percentage or what kind of percentage of data can be referred as to be correct. So, what you can do is, what is the probability of the event, for that matter, to occur. So probability of event to occur. Fine. Now based on that, this is a very theoretical question. So of course you can write about the advantages and disadvantages for that, because here if you see, there will be more objectivity. Subjectivity is missing. Now, when subjectivity is missing, you just can't make decisions based on objectivity, because somewhere or other some part of subjectivity is also important. So when it comes to probability, then there is no very accurate or quick decision making. It becomes difficult because you are going with the probability section. Here there is more objectivity. So based on that, you can write about advantages and disadvantages. Fine, since it is very theoretical, I don't think so there is any need for explanation. So that could be handled. Now, do you think that multicultural society socialization is a big issue? Give your opinion in this regard and suggest a proper socialization mechanism. So now what you do here is, you have to write about what a multicultural society is. So a multicultural society, you people also understand, is a society where multiple cultures are existing. Now the question is that socialization is a big issue over here. Give your opinion in this regard and suggest proper socialization mechanism. That means you have to give your opinion, and since the question is saying that socialization is big issue here, so what you can do is that you can talk about why is it a big issue. Again, very theoretical question. You can talk about the various cultural competition occurring. Then you can also write about difference, or you can say that cultural adaptation becomes a problem over here. So cultural adaptation is there, cultural competition is there. Other than that, you can also talk about that in a society where multiculturalism is there, the issue is that even though there is a lot of social enrichment, but acceptability becomes a problem. So social enrichment is there. But then acceptability becomes difficult. So accessibility or acceptance, sorry. So this is why socialization becomes an issue. Now the question is asking you that give your opinion. That means how you are going to suggest for proper socialization. Now here what you can do is that you can talk about various intergroup contacts that could be maintained. So intergroup contacts would help out. Other than that, what you can do is media representation. Influence of media will again help. So if you see, there is a lot of intermixing that is happening. The paper is, though paper one, it is usually it is said that the paper one is a theoretical paper, but there's a lot of a dynamic aspect that is coming over here. So you can talk about media's role or media's representation for that purpose, because if media is turning out or creating a positive image of a multicultural society, then it becomes very easy to accept it. So media representation, then you can talk about legal policy frameworks. Etc. Fine. So again, this question could be dealt easily. I don't think so there could be much difficulty in addressing this question. See, all this I think you have done in JS paper also, that is your community building approach, etc. Now all this is possible. So here again, you can write about Daniel Goleman's theory of emotional intelligence. That means if you are emotionally very intelligent, then you will be like accepting a multicultural society. Now the next question is that differentiate among a theory, a hypothesis, and an operational definition. Now, what is a theory? This is hypothesis and operational definition. So, a theory, a hypothesis, and operational definition. Now, how you can go about here is that you can talk about what a theory is. So, what is a theory? A theory is a well-substantiated document, or you can say a well-substantiated analysis. Again, this is very theoretical. It's there in your notes and books, so it doesn't require a detailed description. Now, if you go with hypothesis, what is a hypothesis? Now, these hypotheses are based on what? Specific predictions. Fine. Then what is operational definition? What do you understand by operational definition? Now it says that this operational definition is usually measured, observed, or measured, it could be observed also. And at the same time, they say that to some extent, you can say that this operational definition could be a manipulated version also, because since it is measurable and it is based on observation, so high chances are there that this could be manipulated one. Okay, so okay, this was your fourth C question. Now this one is your part one section. The next part I'll be doing soon. So thank you so much.